you've ever read comic books with superheroes, you know that most superheroes have some sort of origin story. Peter Parker became Spider-Man because he got bit by a radioactive spider. Bruce Banner became the Hulk because he got exposed to radiation. Well, primary languages like superheroes have origin stories, although they're less likely to involve spiders, radiation, and toxic waste. But, that being said, every programming language out there was created by somebody for some reason. So, understanding what that reason was is often very useful in understanding what trade-offs were made in designing that language and why. Also, understanding what hardware the developer had available to him. Prolog and Mini Tannerman, while doing similar types of things, look very different for a lot of reasons, not the least of which is when Prolog was designed, an Apple II was a fancy computer that had, 32 kilobytes of RAM, whereas Mini Tannerman was in the modern age where, having several gigabytes of RAM on your computer was fairly normal. So the constraints on the development was different. But back to the origin story. For example, Erlang, a popular language for doing concurrency, was created by Robert Furtick, Joe Armstrong, and Mike Williams at the computer science laboratory at Ericsson. Now, Ericsson builds telephone switches. They do other stuff too, but mostly they build telephone switches. And the computer science laboratory was a group within Ericsson that was challenged to figure out how are we going to build the next generation of telephone switches. Now, a telephone switch is a large industrial device that costs lots of money, has to run for years uninterrupted, and has lots of constraints, both commercial and regulatory, about how it has to work and what it can and can't do. Among them, things like, you can't take the thing offline to fix bugs. The phone company can't say to you, well, okay, city of Chicago, we're taking the entire North Side phone system offline for an hour while we fix some software bugs and upgrade things. If you did that, people would die because they couldn't call ambulance. And lots of other bad things would happen too, but people would die. So you have to be able to fix things on the fly. Now this influences many of the features in Erlang. One complaint I've heard about Erlang is that since it is designed that you can upgrade the code on the fly, for exactly that reason, you can't secure it in certain ways against hacking. You can't secure the code and say, don't want this changed. Code servers, but it's like too alive to do that. Why? Well, because Ericsson needed that feature. Haskell was created by a bunch of university professors who understand what lazy type languages could do. And they got together in a committee, and it really existed for many years as the laboratory language, in which people use it to experiment with programming language ideas. If we add this to a programming language, is it a good idea or a bad idea? This results in a lot of cool features, but it also results in a lot of things in the language that are kind of hard to understand for a new developer because they were put in for some rather advanced reason. Elm was developed because Evan thought web development should be better. And that is really the decision that it should be simpler, it should be easier, and it should be more pleasant. And those are the ideas that led to the decisions he made. Now, you can say that maybe if he'd made other decisions, it would have been better there. But that was the theory. So different programming languages are, again, designed for different purposes and different reasons. And we'll come back to this later. I'll talk about other languages and how they originated. Why is Python or Ruby or Perl or Java or others the way they are, or C for C++, for example. C++. What were the constraints the designers of those languages were facing? What was the problems they were trying to solve? Who were they working for? Who were they working with? Who were their client, their customers, etc.? And we'll come back to that, in future videos, and we'll talk about that some more. So again, consider the origin story of a programming language like the origin story of a superhero, with less radioactive material. Hopefully no radioactive material, in fact. And well, this is the World Wide Web, probably no actual spiders either. Anyway, so thank you. If you found this interesting, please give me a thumbs up down below and subscribe, and I'm going to be putting out more videos on a daily basis, so I look forward to hearing from you, and you feel free to leave comments about your favorite programming language down below and what its origin story is. Maybe I'll learn something. Some of these are pretty interesting in that languages sometimes started in one place and ended up in a very different place just because
reasons.
So I'll cover that in future videos.